Last summer, I thought it might be fun to try something new, a sort of stand-up memoir, taking different periods of my life and turning them into comic monologues. Very popular now in New York. Minimal overheads, show in a suitcase. But, like every memoir, my story had to begin with my being born. And that's where it got tricky. I do not know where I was born. I do not know my natural parents. I always kind of hated them for sticking me with the nuns and the foster crazies. I tried to never think about them. Just like I figured they never thought about me. I thought I was brave. Being a bastard and all. I'd been told that for a boy in my situation, I'd done pretty good. I didn't think so. If I'd been that famous singer Perry Como's adopted son, maybe. Boy, how we envied that kid, huh? The most successful one of us. But I ended up with the Farrells. And not even the Farrells who owned the famous bar. As a boy, I looked inside it and knew that this was what I wanted. The polished mahogany, the brass rail along the base of the bar. This was how real people lived. They had no bar stools back then, though. So I knew when I was casing the joint at 9 or 10, that I'd have to grow a few more inches before marching in and revealing myself as the rightful owner. Ta-da! Jackie Farrell's Bar and Grill. Just like the Count of Monte Cristo story. Oh, I loved that book. The comic book. By the time I was 8, I'd burned through all the classics illustrated. I'd have done it sooner, just some of them were really hard to find. But surprise yourself with this. It turned out the Quinn grandfather, my AM's father, my grandfather, let's suppose, did have, at some stage, a, quote, financial interest, end quote, in Farrell's Bar. That's what my cousin told me, and I'm well into my 40s before I'm told a word of this. You're old enough to know, the cousin said. I could tell right away that by financial interest, he meant bad debt. He didn't have to say another word. John Quinn had fucked it up. The shame. The infamy. First he lost the business, then he lost the house, then he lost his mind. He was dead for decades before he died. Dead to his family, dead to Rosemary, and in my tiny mind, dead to me. When Rosemary and Jack got married in 1948, her eldest brother stood in for her father and gave her away. I'd seen the wedding pictures in the big white album, seen them many times. It was one of my favorite storybooks. And time and again, I'd been told that Uncle Jimmy had to walk her down the aisle because her father, John Quinn, was dead. But wait, he really wasn't dead. Which I was only to learn when I was 10 years old, when she sat on the edge of the bed and told me he had really died. A wet brain. In an asylum. Too much alcohol. Too much tainted bathtub gin. Years later, I wondered if she herself had only married Jack Farrell because she thought maybe he was the Farrell in Farrell's Bar. Which he most definitely was not. But at that moment, when I was 10, all I knew was I was supposed to be sad. I just didn't know how sad. like the time when I was 5 or 6 and my adoptive father took me out for our first outing together. He decided to share something that meant everything to him. So he took me to where the Brooklyn Dodgers home stadium, Ebbets Field, had once stood out in Flatbush. His eyes swelled with tears of pride and loss, but I didn't know how to react. All I saw was an apartment building. One of the tallest I'd ever seen, and I thought that was kind of cool, which I don't think Mr. Farrell liked. But how could I feel the loss of something that I never knew was there? Like my grandfather. John Quinn did not exist, but now he was dead. He became a kind of hero to me. Existing and not existing at one and the same time is wild. Like being invisible. I liked being invisible. When you're really young, being invisible is how you imagine death to be. Being dead means to disappear, to be invisible. Being raised a Catholic, drawn and courted a Catholic, immersed in the reliquary since the hour of inception, I was constantly being reminded that someone or another was always looking down on me from heaven, watching everything I did. The world was a prison guarded by the invisible. I wanted to be invisible. I knew it would be hard work, but if it meant people left me alone, it would be worth it. What the hell? I preferred being left alone. Reading. Always reading. And diddling myself. The Brooklyn boys just can't keep their hands off the package. Now, my adoptive granny worked as cook in a millionaire's mansion, still there, the house that is, corner of 8th Avenue and Carroll Street in Park Slope. She ran that place for decades. She was an amazing cook. How Rosemary managed to learn absolutely nothing from her, I'll never know. To this day, when I hear home cooking, I run as fast as possible. There's a ghost story attached to that house on Carroll and 8th. Though, to be honest, I think it must be a lie. It's said to have been one of the first private homes fitted with an elevator. Sometime during the Gilded Age, the family and staff had gone off to Newport or some such resort town, leaving this wisp of a girl behind. We'll call her Bridget. One morning, she's collecting linen for laundry or something, and the elevator jams with her in it. The poor creature starves to death. Probably a lie, but entertaining enough to be called a legend. Though I never heard anyone in my family mention the story growing up. But then, we were Irish, and never spoke of such things. We bastards are the products of sin. We are marked with it. Our souls deformed by it. Our lives best spent atoning for it. Normal babies look to get hugs. We looked for exits and kept our baby suitcases at hand, at the ready. My suitcase smelt like me. My suitcase was my home. It had a red plaid thing going, and it was tiny, really tiny, little bigger than a vanity case. I liked sitting in it whenever I could, wherever it and I went, and we went everywhere together. I was very proud of my suitcase, and would often show it to complete strangers, bus drivers, shop girls, pressmen. It lived under my bed, and it went everywhere with me. Sometimes it was a boat, sometimes a tiny aeroplane. I could drag it along the floor. All the babies had them. We were like midget traveling salesmen, and what we were selling was ourselves. "Hello, madam. Wouldn't I be a wonderful addition to your home?" You couldn't take my case away from me. My nearsightedness made holding things extra important. If I put something down, I would lose it. Still do. And I'd cry loud if I thought anyone was going to take it. The incident happened somewhere around this time. Despite the many things I can recall from those years, I can remember nothing but what came afterwards. The bleeding. I remember the bleeding. That seemed to go on for years. Rosemary always reminded me that I was damaged goods, and that I could always be turned back into the orphanage because of it. "We can always send you back." I was damaged, and it must have seemed in an unutterably obscene way. I was obscene enough. I used to wiggle on the floor. I said I was making myself pee-pee. In time, that sensation would produce ejaculate, but I was 4. Biology eluded me. And apparently being able to work yourself into taking a piss on cue was a skill at the Angel Guardian home. Well, going to the toilet was a scheduled affair, and you'd be punished hard should you miss it and piss yourself in the bed. Anyway, I was pretty proud of this skill, and would often show it to complete strangers, bus drivers, shop girls, pressmen. No, I didn't. It was bad enough I let Rosemary see me. She took what seemed a very big knife and held it flesh up against me. She told me if she ever caught me playing with myself again, she would cut it off. She didn't catch me. It's still there. Oh, one good thing about the Farrells, they had delivered me from the foster home I was in at the time. The missus in that place was determined I should drink milk. I was determined I should not. This became a standoff. I would be left for hours in this fucking high chair, left there to wet myself. Which, to be honest, was something. At least until it turned cold. Cold and wet. Oh man, I let my lungs go then. I had long outstayed my welcome. That Christmas, the first I can remember, I remember seeing the older boys on their sleds. That looked exciting. I envied them. There were no presents for me that day. I had not been a good boy. They were glad to get rid of me, and I was glad to be going. Crying was all too often the only way to get adults to do what you needed them to do, or get them to stop whatever else they might be doing. I'm so tired of being punished. They say God looks after the fools and the little children. But does it have to be in the same room It's what I fucking hate about all these do-gooders. They want us all to be time-serving robots. No emotion, no passion, no sacred irrationality. Politeness, acquiescence, silence. I don't want to be like them. I hate them. Normal. Normal people have been fucking me over ever since I was a baby. Sometimes I think about pain as a way to focus myself, as a way of staying in the moment, a way to show my body who's in charge, since I'd never be in charge of anything else. You can hold your breath, but it won't make time stand still. You can slit your wrists, but it won't make those who didn't care, care. You can drift through life and call it freedom, but you're still just... They were glad to see me going. My case was packed. That morning, I remember the little boy who lived next door. A natural, but all alone. We'd played since we were the same age. I can't remember his name. But I've never forgot what happened that morning. He had me follow him into his house, where I don't think I'd ever been before. His room was to the rear. Not sure if he slept there or not, but it's where his play box was, a toy box thing. He opened it, and by his gestures and intent, knew me that I should take something. That was the first time I remember ever getting a present or gift. It was a goodbye gift at that. 2 3-year-olds bidding their farewells. My first memory of love. I know it sounds very adorable, but bear in mind, we're wearing snowsuits during all this. It really helped me get my adventure off to a good start. Whoever you are, wherever you are, I loved you. I still love you. You were kind to me, and I have not forgot you.